안녕하세요. MMCA 필맨 비디오가 준비한 시각 마술 변천사 첫 번째 프로그램 캐나다 VR 영화가 현재 그 옆에 있는 멀티 프로젝터에서 진행되고 있는데요. 캐나다 VR 영화를 제작해 주신 캐나디안 필름 센터 미디어 랩의 그 디렉터를 비롯해서 감독님들이 그 오늘 자리를 해주셨는데요. 이 시각마술 변천사는 영화의 기술이 또 어떻게 미학적인 것과 어우러져서 어떤 새로운 흐름을 만들어내고 있는지 이런 것들을 연구하고 또그 결과물들을 소개하는 그런 프로그램인데요. 첫 번째로는 저희가 VR 영화를 시작하게 된 것은 저희 나라에서도 뭐랄까 제대로 된 토론 없이 VR 영화가 그냥 조금은 겉핥기식으로 소개되고 있는 것 같아서 좀더 VR 영화란 무엇이고 또 VR 영화가 가져오게 될 영화의 미래는 또 무엇인지 이런 것들을 생각하게 하기 위해서 이번 프로그램을 마련했고요. 캐나다 필름센터는 오래전부터 이런 새로운 테크놀로지와 관련된 그런 작업을 또 제작을 직접 하면서 연구를 같이 하는 그 오랜 전통을 갖고 있거든요. 그래서 저희가 굉장히 고맙게도 이 캐나다 필름센터 미디어 랩에 관계자분들이 내한을 해주셨고 또 좋은 지금 전시가 이루어지고 있고 관객분들도 굉장히 좋아하고 있는 것 같아서 굉장히 흐뭇합니다. 일단 오늘 강연은 저희 저쪽에 보이신 여자분이 에나 세라노 캐나디안 필름 센터 미디어 랩그 디렉터입니다. 네, 박수 부탁드릴게요. 네. 그리고 바로 이쪽에 그 노트북을 열심히 보고 계시는 이분이 제이리 윌리엄스라고요. 바디만 체인지라는 작품을 감독하신 분입니다. 박수 부탁드릴게요. 네. 그리고 저쪽에 또 점잖게 생기신 분이 갤런 스쿼터라고 보이지 않는 세계를 만드신 감독님입니다. 박수 부탁드릴게요. 네. 일단 오늘 강연은 에나 세라노가 먼저 그 캐나다 필름 센터에서의 어떤 작업 활동, 역사, 또 스몰 원더스라고 경이로운 작은 세계라고 지금 현재 전시 중인 작품에 대해서 설명을 해 주실 거고요. 이 뒤를 이어서 또 제일 윌리엄스가 바디마인 체인지 작업 과정에 관련된 이야기들을 들려주실 겁니다. 또그 다음에 갤런 스콧 감독님이 보이지 않는 세계와 관련된 작업 과정과 또 감독으로서의 어떤 그 작업관과 관련된 이런 재미있는 이야기들을 들려주시고 끝나고 나서 관객과의 대화를 잠깐 가지겠습니다. 그러면 시작하겠습니다.
감사합니다. Thank you very much, Ms. Kim. 안녕하세요, everyone. My name is Anna Serrano, as Eunhee has already introduced me as, and I'm here to talk about how VR is looking at expanding our ideas about what cinema is all about, and how all the experiments in the past about cinema are coming home to be explored again in virtual reality. And with that, I want to talk about a number of specific sort of issues and ideas and thoughts about what we're experimenting with in VR, and then showing you some examples about how those experiments have been developed, including the three works that we produced at the CFC Media Lab, Small Wonders, with the creators Priyam Jhaveri and Lisa Ellis, who unfortunately couldn't be here, Body Mind Change Redux with Jay Lee, and of course, Invisible World, the VR experience with Galen. Before I begin, I just want to talk a little bit about what the Canadian Film Centre is. So the Canadian Film Centre is in Toronto, Canada. It's a 30-year-old institution founded by Norman Jewison. Norman Jewison is the Academy Award-winning filmmaker who made Moonstruck, A Soldier's Story, Jesus Christ Superstar, Fiddler on the Roof. I see someone going like this. Yes. And at the Canadian Film Centre, we train the best and the brightest in film, television, digital media, music, and acting. And we produce a lot of works. The Media Lab, which is part of the Film Center, the digital part of the Film Center, is really invested in VR and virtual reality. And we have a cycle of activities that we run, as you can see from the slide. First, we invest in startups. So technology-based startups, we invest and give them money. We do a bunch of productions in VR, including the ones that are on showcase here. We run labs with partners like the Ford Foundation and the National Film Board of Canada, where we take artistic creators and work with them. We also, in fact, worked with a Korean accelerator called GCEEI, where we took an immersive media startup from Korea and brought them to Toronto. And then lastly, we do industrial research, where we study the VR ecosystem and how it's going to generate wealth for the economy. You don't have to read this, okay? This just sort of sets up what I said earlier, which is that VR is just further exploring all the experiments in cinema. The cinematic imaginary was actually coined by this artist, Jeffrey Shaw, as part of an exhibition he did in the early 2000s called The Future of Film, The Cinematic Imaginary. So what I want to do, as I said, is really talk about a number of key ideas about what we should be experimenting with in VR. So the first thing that I want to talk about is this idea of VR as an embodied medium, okay? What that means really is that in VR, you are allowed to be, feel, or experience whatever the artist wants you to feel, be, or experience. You're inside the medium. Your body becomes a prisoner of the medium, almost, which makes it very, very different from film or other media like that. The word that people use to describe embodiment or to describe this notion of being inside the medium is presence. So it means that you're in the space, you've been transported, and you feel like you have left the world, the physical world of today, and you're now in a new world, the world that the artist has designed for you. So even though VR takes you into a new space, and sometimes our mind thinks we're there, okay? So when you do this VR piece, for example, you get scared that you might fall, okay? Even though your mind tells you that, presence does not equal truth. And so it's very important, the good VR creators understand this, because what they want to do is to investigate and explore the different ways in which we can maybe understand truth through VR, okay? Not necessarily reveal it. So for example, this is a picture of a new project called TreeSense by the MIT Media Lab students, and this lets you be a tree. So it's a VR experience where you end up feeling like what it means to be a tree. This little bit associated with body mind change, which Jay will talk a little bit about later, makes you feel scared about being in this new space, and the space that they brought us into is a Cronenbergian film. Okay. So if VR is about presence, the other thing that's very important about what to experiment in VR is how you can bring someone into a space that they can't usually visit. So another thing about VR is it's all about scale. So it's the best medium to experiment with very small things that you can go into or feel very, very big in a world that you sometimes don't have control in. So in terms of the Small Wonders, for example, this is something that was critical to us making it with Priyam Javord and Lisa Ellis. They wanted to explore what it was like to take people inside a Gothic bead that fits in the palm of your hand. This is a picture of a micro CT scan that we use to scan the bead with. And this describes the process. So the other thing to note about VR is not only do you feel like you're there, and not only can you play around with how small or how big you feel, but it's also an environment that you can move in. Okay, so VR is really one way to think about VR is a spatial cinema. So it's a cinema that you can move inside in, etc. And so this is again also something that has been explored in cinema, for example. So this idea of moving in space as part of the mise-en-scène is part of what Jacques Tati was exploring in the 1960s. In VR, this is explored through pieces like Allumette by Penrose Studios. Here, the way to view this particular piece is it's an island in the middle of the space, and you walk around the space in VR as you peer inside these homes and peer inside the lives of these characters, which are miniatures. And so you end up looking at them like this. Another thing that I think is interesting to explore in terms of the cinematic imaginary as it pertains to VR is this idea of digital materiality. So looking at what is the specific native digital material of VR is something that I think can help us explore the medium further. So when I talk about integrity here, I mean the material integrity of the digital medium. So here you've got a bottle and it has physical integrity because the water does not drip, right? In VR, it's the same thing where you look at the digital material of the medium and you try to play around with that. In the case of Small Wonders, so for Small Wonders, the digital materiality or the integrity of the piece has to do with keeping the polygonal count of the scans as high as possible. So when you see the original raw scan, it was 3.7 points, and then when we put them together, we tried to keep it the same amount so that the digital material was as high resolution as possible, which will help your understanding of what the object is when you go in VR. So when you see it, you see how the resolution is as high as possible, and when you go inside this bead, you really feel like you are looking at almost a physical, you're in a physical environment, even though you're in a virtual one. Another example of digital materiality and the integrity of it is this piece called Dear Angelica by Oculus Story Studio. Here, they created a tool that lets the artist paint the film, and the viewer moves around the environment as the film is being painted around them. So the idea of moving around a space typically means that the user has control over how they understand the experience. So we call that control agency. And in VR, in terms of how we're experimenting with the cinematic imaginary, agency is really, or choice or control, is best when we try to make, when we use it to make meaning, not just make choices on a UI, on a user interface. But in fact, our agency, how we move around, how we choose things, makes us almost be the editors of the film itself. So an example of this is Invisible World, which Galen will talk a little bit more about. But this is just gives you a taste of how someone is moving through this VR experience, and therefore choosing which cinematic planes they look at. And these are just another two examples, which I won't talk too much about. But Gone is an interactive thriller that lets you move through a story, and they have hotspot portals that take you to different spaces and time. Okay, that's an example of a hotspot. And the other one is the obviously the Star Wars experiments at ILM. It lets you, even though they're using the iPad here, this is also viewable on the VR headset. And here you can stop a scene and then change your point of view and then start a scene again. So you can replay a scene over and over again and explore the narrative over and over again. But we can't forget, even though VR is something that we think comes out of the experiments of film, it's actually critical that as creators, we do not forget that VR, because it's part of the digital networked infrastructure of the internet and the web, is social at its core. So this is probably the most different and totally new thing about the VR cinematic imaginary is that we are actually moving into a space where we might be making social cinema, and that is actually more like a play or a game or something else than film. Of all the most lucrative money-making social VR experiences will be multiplayer room-scale VR games. Actually, I wouldn't mind knowing, how many have done room-scale multiplayer VR in the audience? Aha! Do you like it? Yes. Would you do it every month?
Actually, I have divide, so we can just play.
Okay, cool. So so this is where the future is going, and this is going to, and we know this from the VR arcades that are growing everywhere. In Los Angeles, IMAX has created a whole VR arcade. There's an entire sort of VR theater space that's opening up by a company called The Void. So this is a whole new entertainment experience that we're moving into. And then last but not least, this will be my last point about this new cinematic imaginary, is that VR is essentially the ultimate multimedia space, meaning that you can add other people in the space, you can have sort of cinematic elements in the space, you can have graphics and gaming environments and sound, so that what you have is a mix of all sorts of visual practices all combined into one. So here I say, you know, this is where cinema, installation art, interactive documentary, game, and creation, social creation, all come together. And I think that will make for a whole new type of experience. And a good example of this is actually a piece by a Korean artist, Ha Yun Kwon, who's here. In the piece. This is an older VR experience about the demilitarized zone, but it includes a CG representation of the zone that you can explore. It includes these sort of interactive spaces where you can choose and look at the different information that you can find. So it's a good example of the multimedia capacity that you can have in VR. Okay, thank you very much.
감사합니다.
감사합니다. Hi, my name is Jay Lee Williams. Company I come from out of Canada is called Occupied VR. We work a lot with the CFC, and actually the Cronenberg piece is the very first VR piece that we did, and we did that with the CFC. So we kind of, in a way, discovered VR together, right, Anna? Yeah, which is really cool, and it's really great to be here showing it again. This is a newer version. When we first did it, it was about 4 years, three, just about just over 3 years ago. And you know, and I want to say thank you to the museum too. Anna actually put it really well the other day when she says it's the first time that someone's showing it as art. And I thought that really hit home, and I thought that was really a really great thing. And so, you know, thank you very much for having us here and allowing us to show this piece. Did anybody here get to see Body Mind Change yet? Okay, good. Okay, so the way that the Body Mind Change project came about actually was not VR. It was actually a transmedia project that Anna approached me, about directing the video component to it. It had three simulations that you would go online, and as a user would experience and go through the experiences, it would generate a 3D printed pod, which is what this looks like here. So it was a really great project, really cool, because everybody got a unique pod at the end. There was roughly about, I think the TIFF and the CFC had to end up printing about 1,500 of these little creatures that you can see. And so every person that went through the whole experience got mailed their own personalized pod, which was really, I think a new thing for the first time, that is something that generate a 3D printed element to a transmedia project. So we thought the project was over at that time. We were coming to a close, and this is actually at this time is when I first got to experience virtual reality. So I guess, you know, I'm here to tell you my perspective and things that I've kind of gone through in making virtual reality as a film director, which is what I was doing prior. I was doing film and visual effects. Right, so I'll tell you about my first experience with virtual reality. It was a company that we work with a lot named Globalcore, a very smart company in Toronto. And they had the Oculus DK1 shipped within the first week that it was available to the Kickstarter backers. And so they asked me to come over and try it. And when I got there, there was a lineup of people, I remember, and they were all, back then, it was the only thing that was really available was roller coasters. So I hate roller coasters. Like, I'm very afraid of roller coasters. So I actually watched this line go, and I was in the line, and it would come to my turn, and I was just, you know, I would say to the next person, no, you go ahead, you go ahead. But then I finally got enough nerve to try it out, and it fascinated me because it was the first time that I was inside of like a medium that actually affected senses more than just my visual and my hearing. So when we would go down the hill, I actually felt a sense of vertigo. And that, to me, was probably the most fascinating thing I had seen before I first picked up a camera. It also made me very sick. So from that point, I was hooked. I felt that there was something very special and very undeniable about this new media that I really wanted to explore. It was very hard in the beginning. I'll get into that first, but like right after I felt that, I went running up to Anna and the CFC, and I said, "We have to do something in virtual reality." And Anna, being who she is, and you know, having 20 years of working in new media, I thought that she'd be a great person to bring this to. And so she instantly got it, and we tried with a few other properties to do, but it ended up coming back to Cronenberg. So, and I thought that was kind of special because it was sort of taking transmedia to the next level as well in terms of now we can incorporate a virtual reality experience. And I'm going to show you the clip, and for all the people that haven't seen it, it'll give you a little bit of an idea of what the virtual reality experience is like.
Excited to partner with Body Mind Change and contribute to its groundbreaking pod recommendation.
I brought you here because I love you. You fascinate me. You are the perfect person for pod.
Transmits its intuitive life recommendations to you at the speed of thought. Thought helps you pursue a smarter, more purposeful life. It turns you on to new tastes and experiences. Life is now an adventure, and Pod is your partner.
I'm going to talk a little bit about now the early development stages of VR, because it's so much different now, and it had such an impact. In a way, I feel that myself and a bunch of others that I know that were really hitting it early stages kind of suffered a lot to understand the space. So when we first got the headset, it wasn't as good and as fast. The latency was a major problem in the beginning. So when we would develop, it would actually feel like this. So you would turn your head and then the video would go, right? So that would actually make us sick. So in the early stages of development, especially working on this project, our team actually had to make ourselves sick probably about 8 or 9 times, you know, 8, 10 times a day. And then we'd go in, we'd work for about half an hour, 45 minutes, become sick. Then we'd have to lie down, go to sleep for about 15 to 20 minutes to reset our bodies, and then come wake up and then do it again. So we were doing this over and over and over again every day, and this is the only way that we could develop and push the boundaries of what was, you know, virtual reality. You know, as we were developing it, it was like more advanced than the roller coaster. So making a body mind change as opposed to a roller coaster, and not just that, it was also development was also messing with my own presence and the way I saw everything. So I started having dreams that I had no body, dreams of like double eyes, and it was just a really, really strange and interesting time. And I'm glad I got to experience it, actually, because now I think it really helps us understand how powerful this medium is and how much it can affect the people's senses and what we're doing to people, and how important it is to take the user into account and do a lot of anti-sickness development and just make sure that everyone has a good, smooth, and enjoyable time inside of virtual reality. I remember, I'm a pretty happy guy, and I remember some of my friends would come to me like, you know, what's wrong with you, man? Like, are you mad at me? And I was just say, they'd be like, no, man, it's not you. It's just VR, you know? And it was just an interesting thing that how the medium really even just changed and affected me as a developer and as a director. So from the very get-go, it's just been fascinating to keep moving forward and keep having new things pop up and in new ways so that we can explore creativity. Okay, so, I mean, after years of development, months and months and months of development, I think about 18 months straight, because I'm a film director with a strong visual effects background, I really wanted to start filming. The body mind change was CG generated for the most part, other than David Cronenberg, his presence being in there. So I really wanted to start filming, and there was really no pipeline, so we had to develop that. In the early stages, for the most part, we would just plant the camera down and let it and walk away from it, so to give the sense of just a POV of someone standing in a room. So the camera wouldn't move. We were told that it shouldn't move, and this is the best way to go about it. This project here is called Cutoff. This is with Vice Canada and another project that the CFC actually was part of, as well as the NFB. And this project had us working with Prime Minister Trudeau and Native Reserves, two Native Reserves in Canada. Very sad story. I spent just under 2 weeks with these two communities, these two Native Reserves, and we were documenting. So this is sort of a documentary where we are documenting Prime Minister Trudeau's visit to these places to help. The first community had no clean water, and it's a really sad story where the government of Winnipeg sort of took the people off their own land, put them on an island, and then built a causeway separating clean water from dirty water, where they would ship all of the clean water to Winnipeg, and left about 99 natives that lived on this island, and they had only dirty water to drink. So all of their drinking water would get shipped in. And Prime Minister Trudeau coming here is actually the first prime minister in our history to ever actually visit these reserves. And so it was a very, I think, important time. I mean, also, me being a Canadian, I knew very little about what was going on with the Native Reserves. And just to go there and see and experience, in the bottom here, you can see this is how they dispose of their garbage. It's just
a big heap of garbage, and then here we have Prime Minister Trudeau delivering the water. The second community, which is a very, very almost tragic, well, it is tragic. You can see the image down here is basically all of the kids in this community, anywhere aged from 14 to about 30, mid-30s, they were committing suicide. And they were committing suicide to try and bring awareness to how incredibly bad it was for them and their community. And it was sort of sad because it worked. The interesting thing about this project is at the same time we were filming the VR documentary, we were also filming a traditional 2D television documentary. So for the television version, our interview sessions would look like this. It would be framed just generally normal as you would see on television. And for the virtual reality interviews, they would look like this. So you would actually be sitting in a dark room across from the person, and it brought a bigger sense of presence. So the interesting thing that we discovered about the two different formats was that we filmed the interviews at the same time. There was a father that actually was we were interviewing. He was talking about his daughter Joni, who was a 14-year-old girl who hung herself probably about 2 months prior to us getting there. And it was a very sad and heartfelt interview, and he really broke down and talked. Now, what we found was when we demoed this to people, we would show them the 2D version, the regular television version framed like this, and you know, they would get the story and they really feel it, and they would understand. But when we showed them the same interview in VR, people were taking the headset off crying and bawling, and they would say that they felt it in a different way. And I think that like this sort of, I mean, I don't have all of the science, but I feel like virtual reality almost is writing to a different part of our brain than when we were looking at television, almost as if we're giving people memories, or we have the ability with virtual reality to give people memories, and give them a more immersive experience, which was fascinating to me. So the next project that we did, we did after that was, this is way more fun. It was a BMX biker who would ride down the side of mountains and do backflips and all sorts of things. So this is actually the first time, or one of the first times, that we decided that we really wanted to start moving the camera. We didn't want to just place a person inside of an environment and let them look around. We wanted to actually start bringing cinematic VR and the ideas of what we would utilize to make film into virtual reality and see what we could do. It was pretty exciting, and at the time, there wasn't a lot of people doing such thing. A lot of people were just dropping the camera down. So what we wanted to do, or what we did, and we did this with Samsung in Canada, is we put the camera on top of the biker's head, and we had him go down the run and do a backflip and all these things. So, I mean, it was exciting to me because I really wanted to give the viewer, instead of just putting them in a room, I wanted to give them the experience to become the biker, the guy doing the flip. So with the camera on the helmet, we thought that we could definitely accomplish this in an easy way. But what we've discovered is that it would make people sick again, because this is how the footage looks coming out of the camera. Yeah, so what would happen is that the horizon line would actually noodle like this, and every time we put it on anyone's head, again, they would get sick and throw up. So it was sort of self-defeating. So then from that point, we realized that we couldn't show it, so we had to develop a method to stabilize the horizon line, which is what you see here. So all of these pink dots and blue dots, this took about 6 months for us to figure out. Now there's plugins that do it very easy. You can stabilize a shot in a day. But back then, this shot probably took me about a week and a half to actually stabilize. And it went from, basically, the footage went from this to this. And when we realized that when we stabilize the horizon line, people could then go on these adventurous rides and we can move the camera. And so I think it comes back to like the human body and how we perceive everything. If the horizon line is nice and straight, then people won't get sick. So it's similar to being on a boat when you're going up and down and then being on a flat land. So, and this will be my last case study, because this is then again taking it another to the next level. The most recent project that we've been that we just wrapped up that probably released maybe 3 weeks ago was for the Toronto Blue Jays, so baseball. And I didn't want to do putting the camera, you know, sitting still, and I didn't want to just move the camera. I actually wanted to create a physical baseball camera. So, you know, in all of the medias that we worked in, I think that something like this has never really been done, where I actually am taking the user and the viewer into, like, the ability to be the baseball. So up here, right here, this is just an early prototype of the camera. We took, again, we were working with Samsung in Canada. We took it, and I had my guys dissect the camera and build a mold around the camera that's rubbery, you know, so that it would be the same size as a baseball, but still be able to film in a 360. And then what we did is we tested it out a lot by throwing it and figured out a way to counter spin the camera so that it would not be spinning and make people sick again, but it would just go straight. And then the end result was we had the pitcher of the Blue Jays. You know, you start off inside of the glove of the mitt right here. And then the pitcher would grab the camera, you know, you physically, and then throw you at the batter, who then hits the ball up into the air. And so you're basically traveling the full course of a ball, going from the pitcher to being hit to being up in the air to being caught to being then thrown at second base getting the guy out. And that's kind of it. That's all I could go on forever, but I don't want to bore you even further. You know, a lot of people ask me what the future of VR is, especially from a director's standpoint, and seeing that I've done a lot of things and broken a lot of molds that people think that you shouldn't or we can't. And I think that, like, the limit of VR is only based on our own imagination. And I think that this medium is not going to go away, and that I think the most important thing is that we need, if in developing it and directing for it, that we need to take the end user into account and really, really care for them and make sure that they have a good experience. Thank you.
Hello. So I'm going to do something slightly different than the other two. I'm going to spend my time just talking about one project and more about the process of making this. How many of you have watched, have had the chance to watch Invisible World, the VR project? Okay. So pretty much no one. That's good. I will, but I'll give a good summary of it. My name is Galen Score. I'm a image maker. I work in a wide range of platforms and mediums. I used to work with Anna at the Canadian Film Centre, looking at different ways and different technologies in interactive media. I did this project with the National Film Board in Canada, and I now also am an art director at a game studio called BioWare, which is part of Electronic Arts. So I had the chance to start working with my co-creator on this project, his name is Tyler Enfield. He had written a short story based on an experience he had in Cambodia in just around 1994. So this is sort of post-Civil War Cambodia. This is based on a kind of a loose interpretation of an experience that he had. He was a young, Westerner traveling through Cambodia, teaching English, living a very sort of sheltered life. He was, there's a lot of drugs. A lot of the Westerners were going there for very self-serving reasons. And he had an encounter where he witnessed a child drowning in a river. And this is the short story is a sort of a retelling of that event. So the story essentially takes the perspective of three people three strangers live within the same space beside the river in Phnom Penh, and their paths sort of cross somewhat randomly at the event of this child drowning. So it's Jeff who is it's basically the telling of Tyler's story, who's an English teacher in Phnom Penh. The original script is a short story written by Tyler, and it's only the perspective of him. And then what we decided to do for this is actually create a fictional backstory of the other two people that he encounters. So there's a doctor who's named Dr. Vaughn, and the mother of the child who we've named Channa. And it's essentially this drowning of the child that unites the three of these characters together. So that's a little summary of the story. What we wanted to do is really experiment with a new way of telling a story from multiple perspectives. And initially, this was not a VR project. This was one that was developed for the iPhone and for computers.
It wasn't meant for VR.
When we originally did this project, VR wasn't actually a thing yet. It hadn't. So it's probably about 5 years ago that we started developing this before VR was known. So what we wanted to do is, and I'll show a quick little clip that demonstrates what the project looks like, is we wanted to create a film that was based on layers, three layers of video that are stacked on top of each other. And the user essentially uncovers or reveals, peels back these layers to create unique compositions. So essentially, these three images would be three videos stacked on top of each other, and the user, as you're watching the film, pulls back the layers. I'll begin to show what it actually looks like now. So in this case, what's being demonstrated are someone's fingers actually manipulating these screens. And this is what it looks like on the phone.
I ride behind him, straddling the torn seat, and Krista holds on to no one's. Sunday, sunny ride, wind licking the salt from our intelligent skin, running its fingers through sun-hot hair. We are wind-driven, dust-crunching deities on motorcycles, devouring the sugar in our own blood with bright human teeth, because nothing is meaningless in a civil war.
So obviously, split screens in cinema is not a new thing. It's something that's been done, and has a rich history over the history of cinema. And what's powerful about it, of course, is that it really allows the filmmaker to play around with the form of filmmaking. So, changing perspectives and having multiple perspectives within one frame. So having multiple frames, but, showing from different locations. So a classic example would be Time Code by Mike Figgis, where he had four cameras running in parallel from four perspectives, and those four screens are shown simultaneously, giving the audience multiple views from the same multiple perspectives of the same story. Another powerful aspect of split screen is the idea of juxtaposition, where you can show contrasting elements side by side to add a new layer of meaning to the image. And lastly, it also really allows this filmmaker to play around with time and space within the story. So being able to show a backstory the past and the present simultaneously. So the other thing we're really interested in is experimenting with the form of filmmaking and how the story ultimately is presented to an audience. And so there are three versions of that, of the experience. It's the exact same story, but it's the reinterpretation of the film itself into these different platforms. And so we have the mobile experience, which is much more of a sort of tactile and intimate experience that you saw in the previous clip. We have an installation version that's similar to the mobile, but much larger, and allows people to use their body to interact with the screens with sensors. And then, of course, we've got the VR experience, which allows people to essentially embed themselves into the film in a sort of a more physical experience. So some of the key principles that we wanted to embed into the experience are the following. So we really wanted to, in the same way that film has a sort of real-time linear experience that allows people to sort of not lose the user experience, there are essentially three things. There's the kind of the real-time editing. So we never pause the film, essentially. There's one place where you pause, and I'll get that to later. But we wanted the experience to be sort of continuous and allow the audience to actually, in a way, edit the film in real time. The other really critical thing, for me anyways, and I find that a lot of sort of interactive experiences suffer from this, is that the momentum of the film, the momentum of the story, is often paused. And so there's sort of a menu, often there's a sort of a menu selection within interactive experiences where you come to that point, the story stops, you make a selection, and then it continues. What was critical for this piece was to think of a way to tell that story, still have this sort of real-time editing interactivity, but always keep the momentum going. So the film doesn't stop, it's always linear, but the user's experience is always, the user still has that sense of control and interactivity, but the story is nonstop. So I'll talk a little bit about the pre-production process. And so really thinking ahead of the shoot, how we would take the script and really do as much sort of planning up front, so that while we were actually on the shoot, that we weren't just making things up. So really thinking about the film structure. I'll actually skip ahead in time to post-production, and this is actually our editing room. So we had, we shot in Cambodia for about 2 weeks. We had everything storyboarded ahead of time as much as possible, and then when we came back, we went through all our footage and essentially created still images of every single shot that we had made. And then we put the script up on a wall and then started to build the image relationships and the actual film posted on a wall. So you could actually see little scraps of paper for each line in the film. And then we would actually literally stick the pictures of the film underneath those lines, and then building those, always thinking about the relationship between the three images that would be shown simultaneously. It's my timeline for the editing process. Believe me, it wasn't easy, but we did it. So obviously we didn't want to just create sort of random moments. A lot of it was thinking about ways, the relationship between each of the frames, and thinking about also ways that the user would have moments of discovery. And so in this particular case, really thinking about multiple perspectives. So you have the doctor on one side with the main character, and then the patient that he's working with on the left. When the user pulls back these two frames, you're shown actually what the doctor and the patient's looking at. And in this case, he's an amputee, and the doctor is wrapping his leg. Here's another example where we're playing with time and space. In the middle screen is the one of the main characters, the mother. On the right is actually her years ago when she was living in a village. So this is sort of more past and present. And then the next one is actually if you were to take the image on the left and drag it over, you would actually see that she's hiding. And in this particular scene, she's hiding from some militia that are running into the village. And then the last example is, again, thinking about time and space. In this particular case, the mother is thinking back to the time when she was married. You see the picture of the wedding on the left. You see the actual memory of the wedding on the right. And then she is grieving for the loss of her husband in the middle. And then lastly, we're thinking about juxtaposition, and in this particular case, really about the use of symbolism and metaphor within the story. And so the use of fire and water and on the right, the drowning of the child. And this brings us to the future, where I had the opportunity to work with Anna. And starting, because of the nature of how we shot this, it actually allowed us to think about how to take these layers of film and think about them in a much more sort of physical space that is not possible in reality, but that VR actually allowed us to explore. And so what we did in the VR space, and this, what I'm gonna show is, a early proof of concept of what the actual experience looks like. So in this particular case, we've actually created a sort of a virtual model where the person is actually, their body is actually moving in physical space, walking around, and the screens are actually immersed around them. It's a little hard to get a sense of how what it feels like without actually being in it, but it's almost like the film, these planes of film are actually surrounding you and moving around you as you move in the space. Okay, I'm going to leave it there. If you want to, obviously we have the VR experience next door for the next couple days. The linear version or the desktop version can be seen at invisibleworld.nfb.ca, and you can also download a French, Khmer, and English version at the iTunes store. If you just go to the iTunes store and search for Invisible World, it'll come up. But thank you very much.
Anna Serrano, Media Lab, Director, and Jelly Williams, and Galen Scroll, 이 세 분의 이야기를 들으셨는데, 혹시 질문이 있으시면, 네, 질문을 좀 받겠습니다. 네.
아카이브 기술 중에 음판에다가 그 옛날 고서를 이렇게 그 나노 기술을 이렇게 집어넣는 게 있다고 이렇게 예전에 그 흥미롭게 접한 게 있는데요. 해상도나 나노 기술이나 그 입자의 시약 그러니까 퀀텀 포에틱스나 이런 거에 대한 그 약간의 그 견해가 있으면 좀 말씀 좀 부탁드리고요. 그 서양 그 고서들이 그 중세나 근세 그 옛날 서적들이 그 타이포그래피가 굉장히 이렇게 예쁘고 이렇게 기하학적이고 그런 거를 이렇게 이 VR로 하면 정말 그 독서의 황홀경이 될 것 같고요.
혹시 그 스몰 원더스라는 경이로운 작은 세계라는 VR 예, 예. 작품 보셨나요?
아, 죄송하지만
아 네. 네. 그러니까 좀 그 작품과 약간 연관이 예, 되는 것 같기도 해서 그 질문을 에나 세라노 디렉터한테 물어보면 어떨까 싶습니다.
저 하나만 좀 영화 역사일 텐데 그 나름 실감나는 그런 시도를 한 감독 중에 그 로베르 브레송이나 고다르나 큐브릭을 개인적으로 이렇게 꼽고 싶은데요. 이 감독들은 그 한 씬을 그 한 씬이 한 세계인 그런 세계관을 가지고 있는 것 같습니다. 그 문이나 창문이나 그 전쟁이나 서부극의 그 풍경이 이쪽과 이쪽의 세계가 다른 그런 것과는 나름 확장됐다고 시도를 하는데요. 그 이렇게 기술이 발전하면 그 실험 영화라는 그 빛과 그림자, 정물화를 나름 추구하는 이런 데에서는 그 이런 기술적인 무브먼트 그 말 그대로 무브먼트 이렇게 왔다 갔다 하는 뭐 그런 거 해서요. 이런 것들의 가치가 뭐 올라갈 것 같다고 추측은 하고 있습니다만 어떻게 생각하실런지 모르겠습니다.
VR 영화와 이렇게 그쵸? 관련이 있는 질문이라고 맞죠?
네. 그러니까 저는 그렇게 생각합니다만 네, 죄송합니다.
그러면, 네.
무브먼트에 관해서 꼭
네, 어떤 프레임을 갖고 예. 있는 이미지의 움직임과 연관해서
그렇죠.
예, VR 예. 영화의 어떤 속성이라 그럴까요? 그런 쪽으로 질문을 드리면 될 것 같습니다. 그러면
So that's a great question. So I think the answer actually is in AR. Okay? Augmented reality. Because the biggest problem with VR right now is you can only move in a space that's that's limited. In order to move from space to space, you have to teleport into a different space. Because my movement in VR is captured by sensors. But with AR, you really have the ability to move into a new world through the AR environment, and you can use the entire world as your canvas.
Wow.
Do you know what I mean?
Kind of.
Has anyone seen ARKit? ARKit? It just got released by Apple. So they have an ARKit, they have a portal that you can see, and you move into a different world.
So just touching on the fact that you actually mentioned Kubrick, because I studied a lot of directors too in terms of and tried to figure out what would work best inside of VR. Like Cronenberg, the way he directs, he would have been an incredible virtual reality director in terms of 360 video. But Kubrick, when studying him, because he's so symmetrical, so, and symmetry inside of virtual reality is actually it's extremely pleasing subconsciously to anyone viewing. So Kubrick would have been an incredible director in the way that he moved his story, and the way that the symmetry inside of his movies actually would have translated incredibly well inside of VR.
Samsung이라든가 그런 식으로 협연해가지고 뭐 VR 관련한 센터들도 열심히 생기고 있고 이런데. 그 전반적으로 영화 산업계 그러니까 할리우드를 위시한 어떤 산업 그런 전체 구조가 있잖아요. VR이 확실히 이제 그쪽에서도 이용이 될 건지 어떤 그 정말 상업적인 목적으로서의 VR 영화가 어떤 형태로 존재하게 될 건지 극장은 계속 있어야 되는 건지 그런 질문을 좀 하고 싶어요.
No. No, there will always be theaters and VR experiences. VR will never replace theaters. Because of the immense amount of money that Hollywood is putting into VR, so lots of different Hollywood funders are putting money into VR studios and things like that. I think that VR is going to try to be a lot more mainstream and commercial than other interactive storytelling media. Like, so for example, interactive documentary, there's lots of really great examples of interactive documentaries on the tablet, on the computers, but the market is teeny weeny. Like for VR, because of the amount of investment by Hollywood, it will be a lot bigger, even though mainstream audiences, it's unclear whether they will necessarily prefer it to other forms of media.
네, 질문이 많네요.
아, 네. 그 강연 감사드리고요. 저는 기술적인 부분에 좀 궁금한 점이 있는데 맨 처음에 두 번째 강연에서 뭐 타임랩이 좀 있거나 예를 들면 머리 돌렸는데 안 따라오거나 아니면은 뭐 월미 문제 같은 걸 많이 말씀해 주셨고 아니면 수평선이 움직이는 그런 문제를 말씀해 주셨는데 지금 현재 가장 챌린징한 기술적인 이슈가 무엇이 있는지 궁금합니다.
Well, I actually think that the most challenging thing, I mean, because, you know, we're very passionate at my studio, Occupy VR, about making virtual reality, but the money that's coming from, for us to make this a lot of the time is coming from clients that want the projects done very fast. So it's actually, we haven't had a lot of time to really spend, I always feel like we're rushing. Because the client, you know, a client would just want it right away because they want to show it, they want to put it out, they want to beat everybody else. So I feel like time is sort of one of the things that that is a challenge is getting enough time to make VR. Technically, I think that there's a lot. I think that the technology is moving very fast, and you know, there's a plug-in now that would. You know, take, you know, one push of a button, whereas, you know, a couple of years ago, it would take me 3 weeks to do the same thing. So, I mean, it's not so, that's not so challenging. I guess that's more of a pleasurable thing.
Another major hurdle, I think, is really holding things back is just the user base. And we're still at a place where a lot of bigger companies are really interested in VR, but have not made a big leap and investment in it, just because it costs a lot of money, costs a lot more money. And so coming from the video game industry, you know, EA, Electronic Arts, is very, I mean, they're looking at the space. I can't talk about specifics, but, you know, it takes a lot of money, and without that sort of multi-million user base, it's hard to actually make that first step. So you're still seeing a lot of sort of smaller studios, smaller you know, experiences that may only take you know, a month or two to make. But when you're talking about you know, developing something over a course of 2, 3, 4 years, like AAA games, I think that's you know, it'll be interesting to see if we ever get to that point where the user base is millions of people as opposed to, you know, hundreds of thousands.
네, 아까 또 질문.
예, 그 아무래도 앞에 나왔던 뭐 프로그래밍적인 부분부터 해서 봤을 때 최신의 그 오큘러스에 공개되었던 얼트레이션 같은 경우에도 유니티 엔진 기반으로 만들어졌고, 그 외에 설명됐던 펠로즈 스튜디오의 알루메트 같은 경우에도 언리얼 엔진으로 만들어졌죠. 그래서 많은 VR 영화들이나 컨텐츠들이 게임 엔진 기반으로 만들어지고 있고, 게임 엔진들도 또 영화적인 요소들을 갖다 직접적으로 활용하려고 하고 있습니다. 그래서 굉장히 영화와 게임 사이에 경계가 모호해지고 있는데, 근미래에 그 영화 자체가 가지고 있는 정확한 정의가 어떻게 될 것인지 그거에 대해서 궁금합니다. 그리고 게임과 어떻게 차별화가 될 것인지도 궁금합니다.
Well, you know how you well, the way to differentiate between game and cinema as cinema becomes more game-like is intention. Okay? So with games, you solve a puzzle, you find a treasure, you kill someone. So the goals are very specific. In cinema, you try to understand the human condition, you try to understand another person, you try to understand yourself. So you can get to those different things using game engines. But I think that's, and one can have, so trying to understand myself could have some puzzle-like elements, but the ultimate sort of intention of the creator is to give me a better sense of who I am as a person. And in games, you could have no puzzles at all, but the intention is to kill someone else, and that's what the purpose of the game is. So I think cinema and game will be determined by the intention of the creator.
And just to answer the other part of his question, I think that the term that is being thrown around right now is immersive entertainment, which is the merger of all of these things and being immersed in, I guess, entertainment as we know it now.
And I think it's also very safe to say there's a lot of game studios that are constantly thinking game-like or cinematic, and the language of cinema is not absent from what they're doing. And in the same way that you know, in some ways, cinema is, filmmakers are often thinking about how their experiences could live within a game world. So I think more and more we're going to see that blending, but there will always be sort of the intention of the creator biasing one way or the other. But I think there will be more and more examples, and you're seeing this already with a lot of game studios, the sort of the incredible immersive stories that they're creating that span hundreds of hours, and characters that are just as rich as you'll find within any movie.
지금 방금 한 질문하고도 연관될지도 모르겠는데 한 가지 구체적인 예로서 인비즈블 월드를 제가 설명을 들으면서 생각난 게 구로저 아키라 감독의 라쇼몽을 어떤 의미에서는 이건 저기 그 VR 같은 이런 기술을 이용해 가지고 재구성해 가지고 영화할 가능성이 있지 않겠느냐 생각되는데 어떻게 생각하시는지 좀 알고 싶습니다.
The hardest part about VR, a challenge, is actually how to tell an immersive story in it. There's still a lot of techniques and sort of language of VR cinema that need to be sorted out. I think we can learn from films like Kurosawa's films as hints of what we can do, but where it gets challenging is in VR, unless you're doing what we did with Invisible World, where the cinematic plane, the cinematic object is a plane, and you're moving around these planes of cinemas, then what gets difficult is if you try to do a Kurosawa film with multiple perspectives and layers in an immersive space, in a 360 environment. That's where it gets a bit tricky. But I'm very interested in finding out how to do that.
Individual World 아까 그 프레젠테이션 하실 때 제가 한 가지 궁금했던 게 앵글이 세 가지가 나오는데 거기에서 이쪽은 이제 그 여자와 남자가 결혼한 사진이고 이쪽은 결혼할 때의 모습이고 그리고 가운데가 이제 그 남편을 잃었을 때의 그 장면을 제가 봤는데 그러면 그거를 중간에 그 유저가 이렇게 드래그 하지 않으면 가운데에 있는 그 애도하는 것은 유저가 보지 못하는가? 저는 그 부분이 굉장히 퀘스천이었고 그렇다면은 감독이 의도하고 있는 전체적인 트립 앵글을 다 유저가 인식하지 못하고 스토리를 다 이렇게 얻어가지 못하는 부분도 있지 않나? 그런 부분에서는 그거를 어떻게 전달할 것인지에 대해서도 사전에 다 생각하시고 찍으신 건지 그러니까 제가 봤을 때 아까 그 앵글에서 가운데 남편이 애도하고 있는 그거가 가장 중요한 핵심 포인트라고 생각하는데 만약에 유저가 그거를 드래그해서 밀지 않는다면 그 장면은 보지 못하는 거잖아요. 그러면은 그거는 어떻게 전달이 될 수 있는가에 대해서 트리 앵글을 어떻게 그러니까 이해되시죠 질문이 스킵될 수 있는 그러니까 유저에 의해서 스킵될 수 있는 어떤 지점이 있지 않나 그걸 어떻게 전달할 수 있는지에 대해서 궁금합니다.
Good question. And that was really the challenge that we always had to overcome in production and post-production, that we find that right balance of telling a really emotionally rich story. And still giving people just a sense of what's the word?
Agency.
Thank you. Where they have, you know, it's what I like. What I love about interactivity is the sense that you have these moments of discovery. They may not be super critical to the overall story. You'll still walk away and understand what the story is, but the difference of a film director just showing you something and only showing you what that the director wants you to see and you discovering something on your own is much more impactful. So that discovering, and there's lots of examples that in this that, you know, you could watch the experience 3, 4, or 5 times, and every single time you'll discover these little nuances that will add just a little dimension that you hadn't seen before. But the overall story is going to be the same, but it's really just those moments for the end user to discover on their own.
This is ultimately the biggest issue or point about the new cinematic imaginary, which is the author no longer has control, okay? So in the new cinematic imaginary, whether that's interactive digital media becoming a space for storytelling, or VR becoming a space for storytelling, or AR, the author becomes more of an architect rather than the ultimate storyteller who designs and tells you exactly what to see and how to feel and what to do, you know? As we move into the VR medium, as the body responds to VR in my own particular way, the role and the power, the ultimate power of the author or the filmmaker is diminished. And so it requires a generous creator who is willing to co-create with their user to move into this new cinematic imaginary.
네, 시간이 많이 지나서 아마 더 궁금한 질문이 있으실 것 같지만 여기까지 질문은 받기로 하고요. 말씀 여러 가지 좋은 질문도 많았고 또 좋은 얘기를 많이 들었는데 어쨌든 저희가 그 기존에 봐왔던 영화의 어떤 이미지의 세계화하고는 분명히 다른 점이 있는 것 같아요. 에나가 말씀하신 것처럼 어떤 디멘션을 차원을 그 새로운 차원을 공간감을 창조하는 그런 과정인 것 같고 또 저희도 우리가 이미지나 공간 속에서 우리가 갖고 있는 어떤 느끼고 있는 어떤 움직임, 몸의 움직임이라든가 느낌들을 새롭게 발견하는 그런 순간들이 되는 것 같아요. 그래서 VR 앞으로도 무궁무진한 어떤 그 연구할 어떤 그런 영역인 것 같고요. 앞으로도 이 세 분의 작업이 좀 더 알찬 어떤 성과를 가져오는 그런 작업이 되기를 바랍니다. 오늘 너무너무 감사드립니다. 강릉 여러분 감사합니다.
감사합니다.